Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship on this last Sunday after Pentecost, the feast of the reign of Christ, when we celebrate that Jesus is Lord, which means that nothing else in this world is. Whether you're joining us live on Sunday morning or you are watching this recording later, we're happy you've chosen to worship with us today. Let's take just a few moments now in silence to remember that Christ is present with us as we worship him. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is coming.
Oh, come, let us worship.
Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia.
Please join in singing our opening hymn, The Days of Elijah. Join as together we sing say together the psalm known as the Jubilate, the jubilation psalm, Psalm 100. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song.
Know this, the Lord himself is God.
He himself has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving, go into his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him and call upon his name.
For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting.
And his faithfulness endures from age to age. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Our first reading is taken from the book of Ezekiel and will be read for us by Ife.
For thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out as shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep. So I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the watercourses and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I'll feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, but the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted at all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide. I will save my flock, and they shall no longer be ravaged, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is taken from Ephesians and will be read by Mary.
I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your faith and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Please join in singing our gospel hymn, King of Glory.
And also with you.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteousness into eternal life." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, y'all got to hear the very first Bible passage that made me terrified of hell. My Methodist youth group, which didn't spend a whole lot of time on hell, wasn't super interested in a fear-based approach, took a field trip to worship with an evangelical youth group that chose differently. I have such a strong memory of falling to my knees in that repurposed movie theater as the music swelled around us, counting up the number of hungry people I had fed, of naked people I'd clothed, the number of strangers I'd welcomed, the number of sick and imprisoned I had visited, and realizing, boy, did I come up short. I knew then, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that I had not done enough to avoid being rejected by Jesus, who I loved more than anything, and cast out into the outer darkness, where there is wailing and gnashing of teeth. There's something almost primal about this fear. So many people are terrified of hell, and the whole recent Christian history is a response to this fear. Some churches lean into it and use it to manipulate their members into better behavior, like that church I visited those many decades ago. Others have scrapped the idea of hell entirely, throwing the biblical baby of judgment that Jesus proclaims today out with the bathwater of such spiritual abuse. And I confess I'm sympathetic to that approach, because when we fear rejection, we reject others. When we fear judgment, it makes us awfully judgy. When we fear losing, we make sure that we only associate with the winners, which is just the wildest response to this story. Because you see, the goats that Jesus is talking about, long before they got sent away from the throne of Jesus's glory, these rejected were first rejectors who sought to avoid being associated with the least of these who are the members of Jesus's family. It is their rejection of the least, the last, the losers of this world that got them into the mess they're in. Because when we view the world as a dog-eat-dog kind of place, you sure as heck cannot allow yourself to be classed among those at the bottom. It's like high school. If you let the smelly kids sit at your table, everyone will start calling you smelly too. And if you start doing things like feeding hungry people, buying up grocery cards to give to folks just because they asked and for no other reason, people might start to look at you sideways. Not to mention what'll happen if you go from there, keep going through Jesus's list. About 4 years ago, the U.S. started slashing the number of refugees they admitted every year. And people defended this move by saying, well, are you willing to accept a fugitive from a dangerous neighborhood into your home? Might bring danger with them. They might bring your property values down. If you visit the sick, you might get sick. And if you're friendly enough with criminals to visit them in prison, people might start thinking you might be a criminal too. Associating with the losers of this world says to the winners that you've chosen poorly and you deserve whatever rejection results. But Jesus says differently. In fact, the whole of Scripture says differently. Long before Jesus was born, the prophet Ezekiel tells God's people that they don't have to win in order to be accepted by their shepherd. They don't have to do anything at all. Through Ezekiel, God promises not even to wait for us to gather before his heavenly throne, hoping to be accepted into his kingdom. God himself will come forth from heaven to seek out the lost, to bind up the brokenhearted, to rescue his sheep, no matter where they have wandered. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered. I will feed them with good pasture. They shall lie down in good grazing land. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. I will feed them with justice. These are not the words of a God who rejects. And if they aren't enough for us, then Jesus himself is the confirmation of this promise God makes through Ezekiel. Jesus himself, though in the form of God and equal with God, ruling the universe on the throne of glory, in the kingdom of his Father, prepared before the foundation of the world, did not hide behind all that power and glory, but emptied himself. He took the form of the lowest of the low, the form, scripture says, of a slave. Because in order to fulfill that promise, he needed to. He needed to become one of us in order to seek out the lost, bind up the injured, strengthen the weak, and bring back the strayed. He did not wait for us to be ready to receive him as king before he came to rescue us. And when he came to rescue us and we utterly rejected him by putting him to death on a cross, he never rejected us. In his mighty resurrection, he opened the grave and gate of death to make it possible even for those who had crucified him to enter his kingdom, not by our own merits, but through his gracious gift. We cannot be rejected by the one who has already died for us, no matter how little we have done to deserve it. His acceptance is accomplished. So we don't have to count up how many hungry people we've fed or how many sick beds or prisons we visited to punch our heavenly ticket and avoid being cast into the outer darkness. Jesus has already opened the door. But here's the thing. The door that he opened that leads the way to his glorious kingdom, where peace and justice reign and he makes us to lie down in green pastures, is a door located among the losers. The kingdom of heaven, as we have seen all this year, our entire journey through the Gospel of Matthew, is an upside down kingdom. Except, say it with me, I've said it enough times, it's God's, so it's really right side up. The goats Jesus is telling us about aren't people who only fed 10 of their neighbors instead of 100. The goats are the people still trying to win the game of life by playing by the world's rules, trying to win by associating with the winners and rejecting the losers. Relegating the poor, the hungry, the sick, and the imprisoned, the debtors, the refugees, the unlucky, the elderly and vulnerable, anyone too weak to care for themselves, anyone whose appearance makes us feel ashamed, relegating these members of God's family to wail and gnash their teeth in this life, in the kingdom of this world. A preacher has said the only way into the kingdom Jesus promises is with a letter of reference from the poor, because it is the poor that Jesus came to pursue. Not the winners of this life, not the fat sheep and the strong. Jesus's kingdom is full of losers, and if we want in, we're gonna have to spend some time with them, and we're gonna have to realize that label describes us too. Not because Jesus will reject us if we don't, but because by accepting the least of these who are members of his family, whether that means the parts of ourselves that make us ashamed, or the people out there who uncomfortably remind us of those parts. We accept those sought out at great cost by a God who loves us. And Jesus says, when we accept them, we accept that same God who chose them and us before the foundation of the world. Amen. Just a minute here while I load up our next part of the service here. Trusting that Christ is King, let us confess our faith as we say.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us offer now our prayers of the people, responding with the portion printed in bold.
Serve the Lord with gladness and come before God's presence with a song. Let us pray together, saying, we give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, you have been made head over all things for the church. May we worthily live as your body in our world. Work your great power in and through us. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, you gather all the nations of the world to yourself. Bless the world's suffering with your everlasting mercy. May the oppressed be fed with your justice. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, it is from your hand that all are, it is from your hand that all are fed. Inspire righteousness in all people, that the hungry may be fed, and the thirsty given clean water to drink. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, you care for those in prison. Give us hearts for all those who are incarcerated. Where there is crime and violence in our city, offer your peace. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, you are good. We pray you seek the lost, bind up the injured and strengthen the weak. We pray for those who have asked for our prayers. Maud, Gretchen, Kathleen, Cordell, Ron and Lorraine, and for those on our hearts whom we name aloud or in silence, and those and those who have no one to pray for them. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Christ the King, your faithfulness endures from age to age. May all your saints, at work and at rest, know the hope to which you have called us and the riches of your glorious inheritance. We give you thanks, O Lord.
And call upon your name.
Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in your well-beloved Son, our Lord and King, grant that the peoples of the earth, now divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his gentle and loving rule, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
All right. Are there any birthday or anniversary blessings to be celebrated? Last week, there were lots, which was very exciting to have so many. Type any blessings you're seeking into the chat or raise your hand while I offer the rest of the announcements and we will offer a blessing at the end. Before the service began, we had a member say that they were following the public health guidelines and not going to their cabin. They were staying home, and I encourage all of you to do that. When Corporation decided to move to Zoom-only worship, it was our hope that we would return to in-person worship on the first Sunday in Advent. Bishop Jane has already cautioned us against hoping for next Sunday and has said that we might expect to be worshiping Zoom only for the bulk of Advent. And so I encourage you to please stay home, please stay safe, please follow the public health guidelines. I am so grateful that I have not yet done a funeral for someone who has died of COVID. What a gift that is, and I would like to keep my streak. So please, please protect yourselves, protect your family, and let's try and get these case counts down so that we can come together again safely for in-person worship. Advent begins next Sunday, and whether we're worshiping on Zoom only or we do have an in-person component, we will have a celebratory time. I encourage you to deck your house as much as you possibly can and maybe send us a picture of it so we can all see and share. We will be having a drive-through event in the afternoon from 2 to 3 p.m. next Sunday. You'll be able to receive bags for our reverse Advent calendar. This is our annual project. Instead of taking something out of the Advent calendar, you put items for the food bank in the Advent calendar, and we will give those items to the food bank later on in December. But you can pick up your bag with its list of items and a prayer for you to pray as you put those items into the bag. We will also be distributing prayers for you to say in the evening when you light the candles on your Advent wreath at home. If you would like to add a devotional aspect to your time at home, it'll just be a little short time of prayer, maybe 5 or 10 minutes that you as a family can say together. Ray Lynn is putting together crafts for kids. We have so many things to distribute. I also want to encourage you to send each other Christmas cards this year. I know we have a great tradition of card making in this church and of writing people cards. And I think a lot of people would like to receive Christmas cards in the mail. So if that is something you like to do, I encourage you to check your parish directory and send cards to your friends. We're not going to be able to see each other as much as we would like to. And when we see each other, we're not going to be able to hug and get close the way we would normally like to. So send some cards that tell your friends how much you love them. Let's make this a celebratory season. When we connect despite following the public health guidelines. Parents of children, please contact Ray Lynn ASAP if you would like your kids to participate in the video Christmas pageant. This involves you filming your child doing a short scene, and Ray Lynn will splice them together for all of us to enjoy. She really needs to hear from you today if you plan to participate. So please do so. We have exciting plans coming up for St. Nicholas Day, for all kinds of things, Gaudete Sunday. We're going to try our best to make this a festive and joyful Advent season in the midst of this pandemic. You are invited to join us for the November Anti-Racism Book Club. We'll be reading the book, The Skin We're In by Desmond Cole. That is not tomorrow night. It is a week from tomorrow night. So you have a week to read the book. I think you can read it in a week. But if you haven't attended before, then you need to send me an email telling me you'd like to come, so I know to send you the Zoom link. It is a private Zoom link. So you've got to register ahead of time before you come. I would like to thank Art Vanderleer and Nadia Subrayan for submitting some videos for our weekly roundup explaining what you love about Good Shepherd. That was really fun for me to get to watch. So thank you both for that. I've got another video loaded up and ready to go. If you would like to share a short video telling us what you love about Good Shepherd, Jess and I will happily insert it into future weekly roundups. If you haven't watched that video yet, those videos, multiple videos, I encourage you to do so. I also have some good news to announce. Brad Linseth, who I believe is known to many of you, is coming next Sunday, Advent 1, to be our theological student for the spring. So please do welcome him when he comes. If he calls to have a pastoral phone call with you, he can't come to your house and take tea with you, which is something I would normally send him off to do. But if he gives you a phone call or asks for a Zoom call, please do accept his invitation. He needs several hours of training in order to graduate. And so we are free to put him to work. So please do welcome him, be friendly and kind, as I know you all will be. And accept his offer. It's not putting him out. This is his job, and it's important for him to train as he looks to a future in holy orders. Final announcement. Reverend Maud has returned home from her hospital visit and expects to be home for the coming days. Her condition is quite serious, and we need to be prepared for it to not last too much longer. So if you are a person who would like to write her a call, write her a card or give her a text message, we don't want to tucker her out, but by all means, I would encourage you to do that. It's good for her to know how much we love her. All right, I have not seen any birthday or anniversary blessings announced in the chat. Final call. Anybody gonna raise your hand? I'm scrolling through. Nobody got older. All right. Well, we will then move into our offertory hymn. Thank you to everyone who continues to support Good Shepherd financially, whether you donate during the hymn which follows, or you donated another time, we are grateful to you. It is only through your generous gifts we are able to continue the mission that God has given us. Please join in singing now our offertory hymn, Jesus is Lord.
Splendid power, eternal ruler of all.
Eternal God, by your grace, you have raised us up and enthroned us with Christ in the heavenly realms. Receive all we offer you this day and lead us in those good works for which you have created us. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the God who shakes heaven and earth, whom death could not contain, who lives to disturb and heal us, bless you with power to proclaim the gospel. And the blessing of God Almighty, King of the universe, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you now and remain with you forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please join in singing our closing hymn, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Build your kingdom here and now.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.